Thank you, Jesus. Before you move on, I'm going to have my wife come and just share a word, a testimony. You know, it's a blessing to be with you guys. So proud that it really is. Amen.
Praise the Lord. What a blessing. Man, God's in the house.
Yeah.
Amen. God's in the house. If you can't feel God's presence, then you need to ask Him to pour it out on you because He's here. He's just waiting for you to say, I surrender, Lord. I surrender. Well, I praise God for my salvation. I've been saved, what, 44 years serving Jesus. And He's been the best thing that could ever happen to me. A lot of times we look at one another and we think, oh man, they never had any problems. We were really messed up all the way. And God has saved us and changed us and done such great things. And I just want to testify of now, of right now, of what God's doing in my life. There's such a refreshing, there's such a fighting spirit within me to see that, you know, we've been in this battle for a while, but God has always given us the victory. No matter how high that mountain seems at times, and we kind of like seem like we're slipping off, He always sticks out that hand and pulls us back up. And it's a good fight, God says. It's nice to be able to be on top and not at the bottom, right? Amen? Amen? And if you've ever been in a fight, you know what I mean. But God has been so faithful. We see such great things. We see such a powerful move of God in this new, even in the remnant church. Hallelujah. Call us by name, He's got a task for us again. And it's just begun. It's just begun. But God has really been refreshing me, strengthening me, drawing me closer to Him. Such an intimacy right now. I just feel like God's saying, you belong to me. He's always said that, but there's a different kind of a wooing that God is doing to me right now. And He's just like breaking me over and over and over, like that alabaster box has been broken, fragrance. Because there's been a lot of tears, there's been a lot of battles. But we've always won because God has been on our side. And we glory God for us, He stands beside us, and He has our back. So I just want to praise God for what He's doing not only here, but in my life, in my husband, in my home. My boys are all serving God. I'm so grateful for God. I can see the ministry of God. They're stepping into God's ministry and what He has for them. Not what I want, but what He has for them. And you know what? I just keep on fighting the good fight. And you haven't begun to see the goodness of God. If you just challenge Him and say, Lord, pour out Your presence. I want to be refreshed. I want You to do something new in my life. He will. And I can go on and on and on, but God has been faithful and He'll be faithful to you. God bless you.
Well, praise God. And also, we've been married 48 years. Wow. Well, I'll tell you what, my wife said it all. God is in the house. And I got lost there for a while. Right? It's just beautiful to get lost in the presence of God. And that's what we need to do, because it refreshes you. It feeds your inner man. That's why the psalmist says, God, give me strength on the inside of our inner man. But back to yesterday, I want to first thank Pastor Danny and his wife Barbara. They've been a blessing. We go back a lot of years. We really do. I remember the first conference we went together. He was still single. And I remember we were in Monterey Park, and both of them were there, and they were both single. And God has brought us a long way. And so you guys got some good pastors that love the Lord, magnify Jesus, and just back them up and believe God and do great things. But also, I want to thank also you guys that are here. That we have this conference, of the conference we had just a few weeks ago. Pastors, it was really a success. God spoke to the man, God spoke to us, something broke, something positive happened. So can I, you know, have you give yourself a hand? Because you guys hosted it. You know, when you guys host something, you're hosting the Holy Ghost. Woo, do you understand that? So there's a double portion, a double blessing that's going to fall upon you. There's people hosting the pastor, they're in the front lines fighting the good fight. So I want to encourage you, but again, we want to thank you. We don't want to take that lightly. God's blessed with a good facility, and thank God for that. And so we're going to see good things happen as we go on. We're going to have a conference here also. With the permission of God. July the 13th, 14th, 15th, and 16th. And we're going to believe God for a full house. And down the line, we're going to believe God as we go on. Churches are going to be planted. How do you know that we have this momentum? And we're going to pick it back up. Amen. And And I'm a witness to her. God's doing this in your life, in my life, in our home, our children. There's a freshness, something that's being poured out, and we need to all get a hold of it. Let's open our Bibles and get into the book of Luke, chapter 19. I'm going to just share a couple of thoughts. And I pray your heart is open and that God can minister to you in a way that He wants to and He needs to. How many of you need God to speak to them? Lift your hand. You need a fresh revelation from heaven. It might be an old story with a new revelation. Hello. You know, many times I tell our church and I tell myself, your favorite scripture, you know, we don't even know it. We just quote it. And yet we have the surface of it, the top of it. But see, the Word of God never gets old or gets weary. It only gets deeper and wider. And so when you know a scripture, you go over it and over it again, man, it gets fresher and fresher. God reveals different things to you. You know, if I preach a sermon on a certain topic that you heard just recently, oh, I heard that. Yeah, but God can give you a new direction in you. And sometimes we close up to things that we know when God says, I got a fresh anointing for you. And so that's what God has been showing me lately. But real quickly here, before I read my text, how many know that when God spoke to Moses and told Moses, go tell Pharaoh that I am, and sent you. And so all of a sudden, a long story short, here we go, Moses and Aaron go and tell Pharaoh, hey, guess what? You got to let the people go, or you're going to pay a heavy price. How many know God gives warnings before He moves sometimes? He warned Pharaoh. Pharaoh didn't respond. But my point is this, that God spoke. How many know, when God speaks, things happen. When God speaks, God is going to make it happen, you know. And so I thought about that. Then I thought about the Saul on the road to Damascus. God spoke to Saul. Saul, why are you persecuting me? Fell off his horse. Next thing you know, no longer is he Saul. He's the Apostle Paul. So you see, when God speaks, church, something happens. And so my point to you this morning before we move on, that God is going to speak. And God wants something to happen. But you see, the part that we got to play is an important part for it to happen. See, how many know there's no problem on God's side? It's always on our side. And when He speaks to us concerning our tithing, our giving, we need to respond to that. When He speaks about you and I, we need to come to prayer. How many know? I know that in our church, I'm going to have to plead guilty here. We lost a little momentum in prayer. This virus, you know what? We're going to cast that thing out. We're not going to let it slow us down. Our prayer before service lost a little momentum. It picked up again. Thank God it's picking up. Our outreach and Modesto, it lost a little momentum. And right now, it is on the move. We have about 40-some people out there. Not too long ago, they're going out on Saturday. They're going here and there and everywhere. We're picking it up. We have to pick it up, church. We have to pick it up. So I don't know how you guys are here, but Modesto, we lost a little momentum in our outreaches. And not only that, making ourselves accountable to one another. When we come to pray, we make ourselves accountable to one another. Brother, it's good to see you. Or brother, I didn't see you. Is everything okay? We don't judge you, but we want to make sure you're okay. See, if these things are so crucial in our walk with God, if not, it will just become stale. And Christianity will be boring. I don't know about you. I've been saved 43 years, and Christianity has not been boring to me. Giving, outreach, prayer. I know this is a great church, but even for a great church, you can lose momentum. That's right, you can lose momentum. You cannot afford to lose momentum in the Holy Ghost and prayer in the Spirit. And that God will give you direction and strength and energy for the battles that we have in our own homes, at work, at school, and even sometimes in church. We need to fight the good fight. You see? So when God speaks, things happen. In the book of Revelation, the revelator here, John, you know, he said these words in chapter 19, verse 6, before we read my text. And he said, I heard as it were the voice of great multitudes, and as the voice of many waters, and the voice of mighty thundering, saying, Hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. You see, my God, the God that we serve, when He speaks, it's like my thunder. You see, so that's why when He speaks to you and I, He knows without a doubt that it's touched our innermost part of our being. Now it's up to us to respond to that voice. to respond to it. Because there's so many times we want so many things to happen, and they don't happen the way we want them to, it's because we haven't done our part. We have to and we must do our part. How many here need to pick it up a little bit? Anybody? Yeah, what I mean by that, you need to pick it up in your prayer life, you need to pick it up in your outreach. Outreach is just out in the group, thank God for that, we can do it. But how about on your own, personal? That's important. Bring someone to church. Let's have revival. Because when God speaks, things happen. That's what we got to do. So let me read my text here out of the book of Luke. I'm going to read a little story of Zacchaeus. How many know who Zacchaeus is? Of course you do. You read your Bible in the Gospel, Zacchaeus was a tax collector. But let me give you a little background here. He was a tax collector. He understood Jesus was going through Jericho. And he understood, like everybody else, he heard a lot of things that have happened with Jesus walking through here and there and everywhere. But anyway, I'll pick it up here in verse 4, where the Word of God says, "And he ran before and climbed up to the sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass by that way. And when Jesus came to that place, he looked up and he saw him. And he said, him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide," there's an abide, "in your house." And he, haste, came down and received him joyfully. And when he saw, they all murmured. So the religious folks and the people that were there, they didn't like the idea of him calling on Zacchaeus because he was a tax collector. He was rich and he took it from the poor. So they were bad. But then the religious folks didn't like him because he was a sinner, a coastal sinner. But how do you know? Jesus said, "He that comes to me in no way will I cast out." Boy, he won't cast nobody out. That's the thing we always have to come to grips with. And then he goes on to say, verse 7, and when he saw it, they all murmured, saying that he was gone to be a guest with a man who is a sinner. Wow. Verse 8, Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, "Behold, Lord, half of my goods I will give to the poor." Now, salvation took place, you've got to understand that. For him to give finances, that's one area you know you're saved. When your wallet gets saved, man, you know you're saved. Hello? Do you know that I never heard a sermon on tithing when I got saved in my living room? Never. I was in my living room, God spoke to me, my wife was praying for about a year. Man, I got ready to save. God spoke, I listened, I responded. I got all my drugs and all my cojones and all my drawers. I had it everywhere. I got all my bottles. I threw them all in the trash. And I had no church for a couple of months. So I started putting my tithe money away. Every check I get, I pay my tithe 10%. I give. I had a little bundle there. And then when I finally found the church that God took us to, which is Monterey Park, what happened is all of a sudden, the pastor was deciding, man, this guy makes good money. No, it was about 2 months, 2-3 months worth of tithes. It wasn't 1 week or 1 month. But you see, that was the beginning of God's blessing upon my life. When you begin to give, God begins to bless. Yes. And you see, the devil will always put trials before you. And it's that, in my church, there's dozens of people that man, they are givers, and they are the blessed people in the house of God. They are the blessed people. You know, I had this brother that was struggling. He said, how do we give, and how does that work? So I shared with him, and he said, okay. And he just started giving faithfully, unmovable, faithfully. God bless you, man. Paying 50 bucks, up to 50 bucks an hour. 50 to 50. Farming jobs, a truck, everything, on and on. I mean, there's blessings upon blessings when you give. And here's Zacchaeus. Look at what he says. Man, I will give goods to the poor. How about this one here? And if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I will restore him fourfold. In other words, he's going to repay him four times as more. That's deliverance. That's salvation. And that's what you're going to have to come to grips. You can never outgive God. Never. I remember when we were in conference and we were young pastors and my motor blew up on the grapevine. Going to conference, I left the car going to church. So we were just running home. church, a brother found out about it, said, you know what, I'll take care of it, but before I go there, we got to check our income tax check. The Lord said, put it in the offering. Put it in the offering, my car broke down. The Lord said, put it in the offering. Yes, sir. Put it in the offering. Next thing I know, then that brother comes over. I heard your car broke down. Yeah. Tell you what, tell me where it's at. He picked it up and put a brand new motor and didn't charge me a penny. See, something happened when you did. Hello? I was a young pastor going to conference with no money. Said, God, we can't make it. Some man came to my door and knocked. Said, sir, I don't know why I'm doing this. I shared that yesterday. He said, look it, here's some money that God told me to give you here. Well, I don't want to give it to me. Thank you. That's all it was. And now I told the Lord, start speaking in tongues. Oh, yes, shut the door. Yes, Jesus. God is good. And I said, my God, we're one conference. Yeah. I have people come to my door, give me hundreds of dollars, thousands of dollars in the mail. Can I tell you that you're related to our giving? Whatever we sow, you're going to reap. Yeah. If ever you're going to be a pastor, I always tell you, you better be a giver here, or you're going to have nothing out there. And I can go on, I'm going to stop. I give you story after story after story about God's greatness and goodness and how he moved. But then he said, I'll pay fourfold. Verse 9, and Jesus said unto him, this day is salvation come unto the house. There it is. Salvation is come unto the house. And then, for as much as he also is a son of Abraham, then in verse 10, for the Son of Man has come to what? To seek and to save that which is lost. See, we can never lose the main ingredient to why we're saved, and that is to reach the lost. That is to go out in the highways and the byways, church. Listen to me. Share the love of God. Do you know that when you share the love of God, something happens to you? I know that everywhere I go, even in the prisons, I've gone to prisons in England and here in the States, and every time I preach the gospel and share my testimony, something happens to me. In the park, wherever you may be, you share your testimony that God has done in your life. There's always somebody else just like you that needs to hear what you have to give. And see, here we have salvation in the house. He says he came to save that which is lost. That's why we can never stop reaching the lost. Sometimes we're always crying out just for our needs. No, God says, go reach the lost and not what your needs. Say, go reach that lost person. And man, I'm good with that. So I'll meet your needs, but all you do is cry out for your needs. And no, you need to move and pray for others. You know how you get your prayer needs met? When you pray for others, you get them. That's how you get yours. That's how it happens. It's a paradox. It's something that we have to catch. You have to be able to catch that. So let's look at a couple of things here that will hopefully help us concerning Zacchaeus. First of all, it was personal. Remember, he said, Zacchaeus! He named him. Just like when the Lord spoke to me in my living room. Robert! Yes, sir. It's now or never. So he told me. It's now, I said. I surrendered. Right there and then. And then I always wonder, how come more people get 10 and 15 chances? I only got one. You know what the Lord told me afterwards? Here's down the line. He told me, because I give you a whole lot of chances when you're a sinner. I could have died so many times not saved. Where would my destiny be? So did I complain? No. I'm glad you didn't give me one shot, because man, I surrendered. I wouldn't have it no other way. God is merciful. Man, as a 5-year-old, getting hit by a car, I don't know how fast he's going, threw me in the air. I mean, 30 feet in the air, it took me to the hospital, I made it. But my point is, from day one, man, the devil was after me. And I can tell you more stories, but I won't go there. See, it was personal. Zacchaeus called him by name. When Abraham was called by God to leave the land of Haran, leave your kindred, your mother, your father, and you go and begin a new ministry, and go, and I will make you a father of many nations. When God speaks, things happen. He's followed that path, and we know the story. He became the father of faith. We have Gideon threshing wheat under the bridge. Man, they're being tormented. They're worshiping false idols, and God calls them a man of valor. See, God already saw something that was going to happen to that man, but he had to make it happen. He even asked for confirmation 3 times. God gave him the confirmation, and God gave him a great victory because he overcame the enemy and overcame the odds that were against him, like David and Goliath. But you see, when God speaks, church, things happen. Man, you know, God's going to speak to you this day right now. Whether I speak to you through the word, or God speaks to you through your spirit, God is going to speak to you. And when he speaks to you and you respond to that, God is going to make something happen. He even gives it to you before it happens. God's good. And I know that sometimes we go through things we don't know why or how or how come. We just can't figure it out. He says a blessing is coming. You can feel, man, heaven's going to open up. And I've had these days where hell opens up. I have. I said, God, I felt the goosebumps. I felt the power. God, I felt, man, anointing. But God, all of a sudden, I feel, man, God's going to fall open. Woo! I said, okay, Lord, I'm still going to call upon you, because he always comes to do my name. So, remember, it was personal, he called him by name. God called you by name. That's why we're here. He called you. Now, we can respond to the opposite. He ain't going to stop you, but he wants to help you to go on the right course. Now, secondly, it was pressing. In other words, remember there in our text, he says, make haste, hurry, rush, move, urgency. See, this is our need of the hour right now. There used to be an urgency in our walk with God concerning prayer, concerning outreach. I remember where we used to stand in line to come to church. Stand in line to come to prayer. In line to pray. We were at a conference a couple of times, but I remember one time specifically when we were outside for 4 hours in the snow to wait to get into church. 4 hours in the snow. And the wives were doing at the hotel getting ready. And they would come the last half hour until we had to go and shower and come back. And we would go in there and jump in and look for a seat because they were all full. You had to run in there and get a seat. One for you and one for your wife, pushing people out of the way. That's urgency. See, this is something that's lost over the years. You know, we should be running to prayer. Yeah. I remember the day when you would preach, and people would run to the altar. Yeah. Run to the altar, God forgive me, God help me. Yeah. And then the following year, we go to conference again, and we'd be out there for 4 hours in the heat of 110. That's right, 6 months later. And the wives in the hotel, the cold shower, they were in the heat. Sweating bullets, but it was joy for the Lord, because I wanted to go hear the word of God. I wanted to go pray and seek the God that we serve. That God, when he spoke to me personally, Robert, today's your day. God wants to speak to us and put urgency in us to get back into prayer, back into the word, back into evangelism, back into the heartbeat of God. Oh, we need it. We need it. Urgency. That's our need of the hour right now. Can you imagine that? I remember moving to England and I didn't know the roads yet, so I was going to church of prayer and we were on the road and we got lost here a little bit, but got right back on. And I was about 10 minutes late to prayer. And all of a sudden there's about 10 people in line in the store waiting to get to prayer. You say, this is going to happen again. See, I'm talking about an urgency of people that want to go pray, they stand in the snow, in the heat, man, they just couldn't wait to hear God speak. Yes. Where are those days at, church? Help us, Lord. Yes. Help us not to lose, God, yes, what you have given us. That we don't take for granted the goodness of God. You guys have a beautiful facility here. My God, you can come and pray and worship. Even like this morning, the worship was awesome. Yes. It was good. Man, how could you not want to worship and pray? I'm not coming to the altar. Say, God, I'm that man. Help me. I want to be what you want me to be, Lord. See, Zacchaeus might have wanted to change. He didn't know how. You know those folks out there that want to change, but they don't know how. But can I tell you, you know how. You have the key. You got the goods. But there's folks, Zacchaeus out there all over. know how to do it. See, we didn't know how to do nothing until we met Jesus. Anyway, he constructed. Paul said, I press to the mark of the prize of a high calling of God in Christ Jesus. You see, it's always going to be I'm in Christ Jesus. Okay. And thirdly, it was humbling. When I think about Zacchaeus, the Bible says he was small in stature, no, he was short. So he couldn't see all of the people because he was too short. So he climbed up to the tree, sycamore tree, we just read. But I believe there's a little revelation that not only was the tree getting short, he was a little proudful. A little pride, you know, you're a little proudful, you know, you give them up there. And the Lord called him down. Come down, you come down right now. And he came down. And what did he do? He humbled himself. And not only that, do you know his confession was an open confession? All the religious folks, all the sinners from everywhere, and here he comes down. A pride tax collector. And he went down there and heard the voice of God. And from that day on, Zacchaeus was never the same. One day he's a thief, he's a sinner, he's doing this, he's doing that. Next moment, God speaks to him, God speaks, things happen. He was a brand new man. A brand new man. Right now in our church, I'd love to see people that are struggling. Their marriages is like, they're basically going to divorce court. It's so bad. Next moment, sanctified, saved, filled with the Holy Ghost. And now the marriage, he's talking about a wife. Now I know what it means. It's a good thing. Oh my gosh, shut up.
Should be, and this is a requirement that we need to be in prayer. Yeah.
Those are in ministry. If you're not in ministry, we encourage you to come to prayer. But if you are in ministry, you're an example to those that are not. And if you're going to get ministry, we have to be faithful in our prayer. And by the way, we have to be faithful in our timing. Because if you're going to be a nicer and you're not paying your tithes, you may just pull some out. Instead of putting in. Paul said, give this to faithful men. So that's a requirement. And you and I, can, I know we have a couple people in our church, I give up a little bit. Well, that's not good enough. If you want a ministry, you got to put an envelope so that we can say you're faithful in giving so we can put your ministry in.
Yeah.
So you got to remember, you're never going to outgive God. Never, ever. Let me tell you one more story. Because everything went bad, they wouldn't give money to nobody. Next thing I know, oh my God, how are we going to pay this load? Sure enough, that's my goal. FedEx, a $40,000 check. Woo! I forget. And I'll never forget every time I see a FedEx. Okay, come on. My house is right down the street. I do this again. But that one didn't give me, and I paid it off with a double blessing. My rent went down, and everything went down. And I tell you what, God is faithful. He's going to blow you away. How is he going to blow you away if you don't do the little things?
Yeah.
Man, oh God, help me, Lord. I got to hold myself a little bit here. And lastly here, it was abiding. In other words, today, Zacchaeus, this is what you want. This is what I want. Zacchaeus, today, I must abide in your house. You know what that meant? The whole house got ready to say. If Jesus walks in there, in that house, I must abide in your house. Because Zacchaeus, you responded. You gave twice as much, four as much. You responded to salvation. Now I'm going to go to your house. And we're going to go into your house and we're going to heal the unhealable, touch the untouchable, say the unsavable. You're going to see things happen like this. And you're going to be a testimony of when God speaks that things happen. And here, all these religious folks were mad. And here, the house of Zacchaeus, it was a thief, a liar, a conniver. And they're saying, wow! Why? Because when God speaks, things happen. Can I tell you, God hasn't changed? He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. I am the Lord thy God, and I change not. Oh, he speaks, it thunders, he speaks, and the voice of many waters. Woo! I like that part. I look at my boys, and I know I share this every so often, but you know why I get so by my boys? They got the Holy Spirit too, God. They're not living enough ours. I see them when they pray, when they preach. I go, man, they got better revelation than I got, Lord. Help me. But I see them praying and crying, come on, God. Man, and that's what you and I want. We don't want our kids just to come to church. We want them to get baptized in the Holy Ghost and power. We want them to get their families, to get their careers. No! We want them to serve God. Abiding in the house of verse 9. Let me read that verse 9 one time. And Jesus said unto him, this day salvation has come to the house, for as much as also thus you are from the Son of Abraham. Salvation has come to the household. How many want their household saved? Anybody besides me? And I'm not talking about my household. Thank God we have it better now. I have a man, I can go on and on. It is my grandson. Son-in-law. You know, he got right and saved just recently. You know, I said to myself about 6 months ago, I said, wow, God, you're just too good. You know, and God just moving and moving. But we have household to me. It's just in my own household. My household and I have family members over there in South LA. We have family members here, there, everywhere, many people. I pray for all of them. God, I pray for my uncles, my aunts, my God, visit their home. The same family, my God. I See, the good thing about us, listen to this, I close with this story, is that we have taught our children, our people, all they gotta learn to do is to call on Jesus. Yeah. Whosoever calls upon him shall find salvation. So we have taught our children that. And I have a brother that was in drugs for 40-45 years. He started using heroin when he was about 16, dealing in the whole scenario. And anyway, what happened, he got sick, and so he was ready to die. So I had a flight over there, and went to the hospital, talked to him. I led him to the Lord. And I led him to Jesus. Then I asked him, who do you want to be a funeral? Because our background is all Catholicism. He said, I want you. And I said, you know what? I'll do it for you. So anyway, a few weeks went by, he passed away. I went back there, and I gave the story of the two men at the cross with Jesus and said, because that's kind of, that's what the Lord showed me. Your brother made it just like that thief did. Can I tell you, no matter what, as long as our family was weekend, I was so excited. But he's dead, yeah, he made it. He made it. See, our whole objective, church, is to make it. We gotta make it to heaven, not to have a great time down here on earth. We're not from here, we're from a new colony. We're from above. Hallelujah. We're not from beneath. But you see, we lose that cutting edge. It's very dangerous. But I never forgot that. I never forgot that the Lord showed me. And the good thing about it, all my family members and my brothers and all them, they came and they knew him, that he was involved in big time drugs, right? And I give that illustration about the man at the cross. And I said, Jesus, remember me. Jesus, I'll remember you in paradise. And you showed me to me in paradise today. I gave him that story and he ate it. And that was able to minister to people there. So you and I have hope, no matter what. There's always hope, and there's a breath, and there's hope. And we gotta trust that hope. The Bible speaks about not only a hope, but a living hope. I have a living, I'm living in that hope. I don't just have a hope, but live in that hope. There's a life in it. And we have to understand that. Now that word in Greek, the word abiding means to save, salvation. It means to rescue, to save from harm, heal, and to make whole and complete through salvation. It brings a new power to live the right relationship with God and with others and with Jesus. It releases a new dominion. You're abiding in Christ, abiding in the vine. Releases the dominion and power for you to have victory in your life. Even in your defeats, there's victory. Hello. I like that. Because every time I've been this last time I had the COVID, I was bad for 3 weeks. I got sick. I know your pastor got it too. My wife got it. But got it. And then I said, oh God, I don't want to go out like this, Lord. But that's your call. Let it be so. Man, and I was praying and praying. But I had the victory, man. I had a smile to smile. Dying. Came out of it, but I guess not yet. You know, so we have to remember that the weather gets hard. Really, in the army, my wife said, we've been through a lot of stuff. You know, our boys, our kids. Now, they've been sick 10, 12 years now. But we have some hard times. But you know what we would do? We would never stop doing what we do. As a matter of fact, we didn't do it anymore. Think, devil, I'm going to fight you harder now than ever because of what you're trying to do. You know, someone told me years ago that if you feel sick and you don't feel good or you feel unhealthy or something, goes, go to the hospital, pray, and start praying for those people that are dying, and the devil will leave you alone. Because he doesn't want you to pray for the sick in the hospitals, those that are dying. He needs people to the Lord. I've had people to the Lord and they don't even know. Hey, can I pray with you? Lead it to the Lord too. See, we need to make a way where there's no way. We have to reach out. You know, if you want God, or if you want God to move and reach out for your household, your loved ones, you need to reach out to others. Yeah. That's what the Lord revealed to me. Is you have to reach out for others so that God can reach out for yours. And He will. How many know He does a good job? Yeah. He doesn't miss a leg. He's right on time. Yeah. So remember, when God speaks, things do happen. And the only one that can stop that is you and I. Because we got to do our part so that God can move the way He knows how to. So, this morning, this afternoon, as we just bow our heads for a moment, I want you to ponder.